beginning in the 1950s, some additional people started focusing on some of the key questions, like what does water vapor do in the atmosphere? What's the radiation balance? And then primitive models started to be developed on primitive computers, presumably.
Well, if you're sitting there looking at the 50s, you're in the midst of the debate about whether we can forecast the weather. You're at the point where here are computers that are coming online and people are realizing that they know enough about the atmosphere that they can begin this process of forecasting. That's a remarkable point in history.
Most people would trace back to the Second World War and cybernetics when people began to look into feedbacks among different phenomena. Gradually spread, and I would say it came into climate science in the 1960s as people began to realize, and you can even find points where people said, oh, it's not just one thing that influences climate. It's no good looking for the theory of climate change, because this can produce climate change, that can produce climate change, that can produce climate change. What's more, this can react on that, and that can react back on this, so they're all sort of mixed together.
And by the 1960s, we had really the first global models which gave anything resembling a realistic representation of the climate system. It wasn't really there yet, but it was starting to get there.
This was made possible by the coming of computers, which gave people, number one, examples where they could show these things shifting around. They also, for the first time, gave them the possibility to do some computations. And let's face it, a scientist isn't going to study something if he doesn't have a chance of doing anything with it, if he can't get any numbers out. But with the first computers, they began to see, well, I can actually study feedbacks because I can do some kind of crude model and get some numbers out.
When I first came as a student to the National Center for Atmospheric Research in 1976, and the first Cray 1 supercomputer was coming on board, and they had these first climate model simulations, there was no ocean. It was just the atmosphere, and you'd simulate a month. It was not climate, but you would set up a set of conditions for some time in the past or the future, and you would simulate a season, and that's all the further you could get.
You pick up the story of modern climate concerns. But with digital computing, as we were talking about, the cybernetics revolution. At the Institute for Advanced Study, there was a great effort to use digital computers to make numerical weather prediction. And then by the mid-50s, they were able to make general circulation models. And some of the early founders basically had this notion that you could have a perfectly predictable atmosphere. Put in the equations of motion and the boundary conditions and calculate time steps forward. You'll get to 2:55 p.m. on September 24th, in which the rain will start in Alexandria and move over to Arlington, and suddenly end 10 minutes later. So the intellectual climate was different in that sense, the idea was that there was a Cold War with the Soviet Union, but there was this weather race with Russia, and so these climate issues were highly contentious and highly militarized.
Most of this was sort of in the progressive mode, you know, mankind will control the weather, you know, we'll be able to do this, that, and the other thing. But by this time, World War II had happened, atomic bombs had happened. The first recognized modification of the entire globe by human beings was fallout from atomic bomb tests. That was the first time people said, oh, it's not just a local change. People actually have the capacity to change the atmosphere all around the climate. Now, that was radioactivity because you can detect with the Geiger counter, you can detect the tiniest amount. But that opened the way for people to start considering, you know, that we might be able to modify the entire globe deliberately. And although there was a very progressive thrust to all this in many people's minds, this was after Hiroshima, and this was after fallout, and there was increasingly, and by the time you get to 1970 and the rise of environmentalism, it began to switch, and people began to see this as not largely as it had been in Arrhenius' day, oh, wonderful, if we can modify the climate, let's go and do it. Right. You know, it came to be the other thing, if anybody modifies the climate, you know, they're tampering with Mother Earth.